Bea here, and welcome back to Biology. Our lesson today is about biological ancestors and relatives. Do you know anything about your ancestors? You may at least know something about your grandparents, and some people have traced their ancestors back many generations. When we have information about ancestors, it is common to set up a family tree. In fact, you may remember this family tree that we looked at in Unit 1. We were specifically interested in tracking the trait of red hair through the family, so to make it easier, we created a pedigree. Pedigrees use symbols and colors to represent traits. They can help us determine if a trait is inherited genetically and whether the trait is dominant or recessive. We can also tell if it's autosomal, meaning it's on one of the first 22 chromosomes, or sex-linked, which usually means that it's on the X chromosome. We'll look at three examples of pedigrees today to practice. Then you'll get to explore some others in the lesson PDF. All of the pedigrees we'll look at in this video are based on the organism Drosophila melanogaster. You may remember that this is the scientific name for fruit flies. Why fruit flies? Well, remember that they are actually the most commonly studied animal in genetics. After all, they're cheap, they reproduce quickly, and with only 4 chromosomes, their genes are very easily mapped. So, let's get to know these little organisms! Before we get started, let's look at our goals for this lesson. By the end, you'll be able to determine if a trait is dominant or recessive based on a pedigree, determine if a trait is autosomal or sex-linked based on a pedigree, and predict genotypes of individuals on a pedigree. Before we start analyzing a pedigree, let's make sure you remember the symbols and what they mean. Circles represent females, while squares represent males. These shapes are filled in, implying that the individuals had whichever trait we are studying. They are referred to as affected males or females. Empty circles and squares represent unaffected individuals who do not show the trait. Sometimes we also indicate with partial shading which individuals on the pedigree are carriers, meaning they are heterozygous and carry a recessive allele, though they don't show the recessive trait. Often the symbols are numbered, just so we can easily identify individuals. So, on this pedigree, which individuals were affected or had the trait? Male number 1, female number 3, and male number 9. Also notice the Roman numerals on the left. This identifies each generation. The first generation on the pedigree is often called the founding parents. Another new term you'll need to know is wild type. What does it mean for something to be wild? You might think of a synonym like bizarre, or it might make you think more of wildlife, as in the natural world. The wild type trait is the typically or naturally occurring trait in an organism. In the case of pathogens such as viruses, it's sometimes used to designate the original form of the virus that began circulating, before any mutations occurred. Once changes have occurred to a gene in some individuals, they are called mutants. It's not necessarily a bad thing. Remember that some mutations can actually be beneficial. But those are the terms you'll hear. And remember that mutations can be either dominant or recessive. Dominant alleles are typically represented with a capital letter, while recessive alleles are given a lowercase letter. To have the recessive trait, the individual will need 2 recessive alleles, or 1 from each parent. Those are the basic tools you'll need to study pedigrees. So let's get started with our first one. For our first pedigree, we will look at the trait of curly wings in Drosophila. The wild-type trait is straight wings, but some fruit flies are born with a mutation that causes their wings to curl backwards. This mutation was first studied in 1923 by Lenore Ward and is now known to be caused by a deletion mutation, meaning a nucleotide base is lost. Do you think it's a dominant or recessive trait? We might be able to tell by studying its inheritance pattern on a pedigree. We'll start with two parent fruit flies, a mom with curly wings and a dad with wild-type straight wings. They have five offspring. Three of the offspring symbols are shaded, so three of the five had curly wings. The other two had straight wings, like dad. Do we have enough information to decide if the trait is dominant or recessive? If it was dominant, mom would have to be big C, little c, as not all of the offspring inherited the trait. Dad would have been little c, little c. The offspring genotypes would have been big C, little c, or little c, little c. This is definitely a possibility. Or could it have been recessive instead? If so, mom was little s, and dad would have been big S, little s. Notice we would use S in this case if straight was dominant. The offspring would have been big S, little s, or little s, so this case would work too. We don't have enough info yet to decide which it is, so let's look at the next generation. Three of the Generation 2 offspring mate and have their own offspring. There still isn't enough here to decide for sure, but we do have a clue. One giveaway that a trait is recessive is finding offspring with the trait when neither of their parents had it, because both parents could have been carriers. That never happens here, so maybe it's dominant? We have one more piece of information that will settle this once and for all. We dig up some information about the parents of fly number 10 who mated with number 7 to produce all straight-winged flies. Her parents both had curly wings. The only way they could have both had the mutation but not passed it on to her is if the mutation is dominant. She would have had a 1 in 4 chance of getting recessive straight-wing alleles from both parents. Her parents were both heterozygous, big C, little c, and she was little c, little c. This is why none of her offspring, 16 through 20, had curly wings. They all got only little c's from both parents. From here, we can determine the genotypes of all other individuals. One shortcut is to remember that since the trait is dominant, any unaffected individuals, or empty circles and squares, must be little c, little c. The dominant trait would be shown by individuals with the genotypes big C, little c, or big C, big C. In this case, every affected individual had a parent without the mutation, so all of the affected individuals have to be big C, little c, because they got a recessive allele from the unaffected parent. So, that's it! We solved our trait. It must be dominant. In fact, it turns out that having two alleles for curly wings, big C, big C, causes such an extreme mutation to the wings that the condition is usually fatal, which is probably why we didn't see any fruit flies on our pedigree that were homozygous dominant. It turns out that curly isn't the only possible mutation for wing shape. A mutation in a different gene can cause short, stubby wings known as vestigial wings. The word vestigial is used to describe something that is non-functional or only a remnant of the original. Drosophila with vestigial wings cannot fly, though many still survive as long as they still have a food source they can reach by crawling. Again, we'll use a pedigree to see if we can determine whether the trait is dominant or recessive. On this pedigree, we start with two parents who both have the typical wild-type wings, so they are represented with an empty circle or square, because they do not have the vestigial wing trait. They have six offspring, two of which do have vestigial wings. Right away, this suggests that the trait must be recessive because unaffected parents had an affected offspring. To make it more clear why this signals a recessive trait, let's look at a Punnett square. If both parents are heterozygous, they will display the dominant phenotype, which is wild-type wings. Their offspring could be big S, which would be wild-type, or big S, little s, which would also be wild type. But look at the last box. There is a 1 in 4 chance that their offspring will be little s, which would have vestigial wings. So, when two unaffected parents have affected offspring, we can generally assume that the trait is recessive and both parents are carriers. We feel pretty confident that our trait is recessive, so let's assign some preliminary genotypes. We already decided that the parents are heterozygous, and we know that their affected offspring would be homozygous recessive. The unaffected offspring could either be big S, or big S, little s. So for now, we'll label them as big S question mark. Let's continue on to the next generation to make sure the pattern holds. Pause the video here and see how many of the remaining genotypes you can figure out. And here they are. Check your answers and fill in any you missed. Because we were dealing with a recessive trait, it is good to mark the carriers on the pedigree. Remember that carriers are heterozygous, so they show the dominant phenotype, but they can end up having offspring with the recessive phenotype if they mate with another carrier. Here is the pedigree showing the carriers. Note that in every case where parents with wild-type wings had vestigial-winged offspring, both parents were carriers. We've now seen an example of a dominant and recessive trait on a pedigree. Let's look at one more and see if you notice anything unusual going on. Wild-type Drosophila have red eyes, but there is a known mutation that causes white eyes. Again, we'll decide if the white eyes mutation is dominant or recessive. But also, be on the lookout for an unusual inheritance pattern on this pedigree. This time, we'll go ahead and start with all three generations of the pedigree visible. Our founding parents both had wild-type red eyes, but several offspring in generations 2 and 3 had mutant white eyes. Pause the video for a moment if you need to and look for key hints to decide if the trait is dominant or recessive. Anything else unusual that you notice? You hopefully guessed pretty quickly that the trait must be recessive, because we have cases where unaffected parents have affected offspring. The other unusual observation here is that almost all of the affected individuals are males. Do you remember what inheritance pattern can lead to a mutation mostly affecting males? When the gene is on the X chromosome, a recessive trait tends to affect males more often because males only get one copy of the X chromosome, which comes from their mom. Let's go back to the pedigree and see if this hypothesis holds up. Because the gene may be on the X chromosome, we write the genotypes with an X and superscript. The founding mom was X big R, X little r. Dad had X big R and Y, which doesn't have the gene for eye color. We list a Y just to remind ourselves of why there is no second allele for him. Two of the male offspring in generation 2 had white eyes, so they had the genotype X, little r, Y. In fact, we can fill this genotype in for all affected males on the pedigree. Pause the video here and see if you can figure out the remaining genotypes. Come back when you are ready to check. Here are the remaining genotypes. Note that there are a few females that we can't determine for sure. We know they have one dominant allele because they have red eyes, but they could be heterozygous or homozygous dominant. There is also one female with white eyes, which is unusual for an X-linked trait. But do you see how she got it? Her dad had white eyes, so she definitely got a recessive allele from him, and mom was a carrier, so she had a 50-50 chance of having white eyes. During our lesson today, we saw three examples of pedigrees that could be used to determine whether mutations were dominant or recessive. There's no exact science, but remembering trends such as recessive traits appearing in individuals with unaffected parents or X-linked traits showing up more commonly in males can help us decide. You'll practice with some more pedigree examples in the lesson PDF. And that brings us to the end of this unit on genetics. Next time, you'll have a chance to review and then show what you know in the unit assessment. Until then, remember that biology isn't just science, it's the way of life. Hey. See you next time.